Hey, good morning, Journey Church at Home. We're so happy you're joining us this beautiful September 19th Sunday morning. Thank you for being with us today. So right now, we're going to take a second. First time with us, click on this QR code right here. It is going to be right there for you to click in and say, we want to say thank you. What we do right there is we send you a gift card in the mail to the Mixer, which is a downtown coffee shop and amazing place to get some food.
Absolutely.
It's a $5 gift card, so you definitely get a cup of coffee, but we want to make sure that you are taken care of. And we just say a way of saying thank you for being who you are and joining us today.
Absolutely.
So welcome, Brian. I'm excited to be doing this with you today.
I'm excited to be here. It's such an opportunity to just be out here in front of our sharing time with our online family. We miss you. We wish you were here. So make sure to come join us sometime.
That's right.
We also wanted to say a big, big thank you for everybody who served with the Food Truck Festival. I mean, it was amazing.
It was awesome. It was so fun.
Can't believe. I mean, my pants actually still a little looser than when I started it, but I'm so glad I got to be here at this particular one. We also want to say a big thank you to everybody who has served at the Aaron McNeil House. I mean, it's such a great ministry to be a part of, such a great ministry that really blesses you more than you're blessing them.
I love being a part of a church that serves.
Yes, it's
amazing. We're not just trying to be a church that we want you to come into the building and just be here and then leave on Sundays.
Absolutely.
We want to make sure you are here serving with us.
And it's not just like one or two people. We all serve.
We all serve.
Which is amazing.
We truly are trying to live out the phrase, love God, love others.
Absolutely.
And that's awesome to be about. Speaking of love, coming up very soon on October 31st is Love Day.
Love Day.
So make sure you set your calendars, make plans to be here with us on Love Day. We're going to be going out as the church. We're going to be serving all over the community. There's a lot of different projects. There's a lot of different things happening like that. Yeah. And then also, immediately following that, we're having a chili party to celebrate our church.
Are we?
We are.
Oh, my gosh.
It's a chili party. And we're going to be celebrating our church and our people. And make sure you're there. If you are bringing food for the chili, make sure you bring it at 9 a.m. So we are good to go, but also we're so blessed to be able to serve our community
Absolutely.
In another way.
Yes.
And I love that we're not staying here.
Right.
We're not doing anything on our campus. We're going all over the community to do that.
We're going to literally go and be the hands and feet of Jesus out in our community, which is going to be fantastic.
On a Sunday morning, no less. So
I know.
It's taking the church literally outdoors.
Yeah.
That is awesome.
It's going to be amazing. Yeah. So we also wanted to invite you to something else that's coming up in October. It's going to be our Candy Palooza. Yeah, you heard that right. Candy Palooza from 5 to 7.
I hope Palooza's bouncing on the screen.
I hope
right
it's
now.
Bouncing right across one. Here. Candy Palooza.
I'm so
Fireworks.
I love that word.
Yeah, it's going to be amazing.
It's going to be awesome.
But we also wanted to invite you if you wanted to donate some candy to Candy Palooza. It's basically going to be a drive through. It's going to be just the day before Halloween, a couple days before.
I think it's the 29th. Friday night before.
Right.
The reason we're doing it on the 29th and not 31st on Love Day isn't because of our church, but it's because our community has decided to trick-or-treat this year on the 29th.
Right.
So we want to be there with the people and serving with the community as well.
Absolutely.
So for those families who go to Great Oaks to trick-or-treat right around the corner from us, swing on through, get your kids started with some candy first. No bait and switch here for anybody watching online. We just literally want to just pass out some candy and say, hey, we love you.
And you don't even have to get out of the car.
Just
drive up, get your candy, drive off. It'll be amazing.
No, I think it's great. We're so excited.
We may or may not have some cool lights on the outside of the building.
I would love some cool lights.
I would love that.
I would love cool lights.
I love that. All right.
Ooh, cool lights. We need to make that happen. That would be fun.
I know.
Awesome.
It'll be a lot of fun.
So as we figure out how to make cool lights happen outside the church, I want to say welcome home. Welcome to Journey Church.
For your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. You have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you are
The one that is lost in the darkness, Lord. You always, you sacrificed your life for us because you are so good, God. Today we just say thank you. We say thank you. In Jesus' name. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning.
Good morning, Journey family. It's good to be here this morning. I want to share a thought with you, and the thought is, ministry occurs every day. Say that with me, if you would. Ministry occurs every day. I'm going to give you an Old Testament example of that, and then I'm going to give you a current, so fresh as of yesterday example of that. In the Old Testament, in Exodus 35 and 36, I was reading that the other day, and when I read it, I kind of laughed a little bit. The Bible's really never made me laugh, but this did. And it's talking about giving an offering, and the offering was given in such a way that Moses, who was taking up the offering, had to say, "Stop! Stop! You've given me too much. It's too much." And I thought, wow, poof, that just kind of blew my mind. But that's ministry occurring every day. You don't have to look far to see that happening. As recently as yesterday, ministry was occurring over at the fairgrounds, giving out food to our community, blessing our community with smiles and food, and even some of our folks said a prayer with people as they came through the line. I was so thankful to be able to be a part of that. Another example just happened just this past week of ministry occurring every day. Thursday, as a church, we were able to bless and share a meal with the Newman family in the celebration of life for Brandy's mom. Thank you, Journey Church, for ministry occurring every day. And it's because of your giving that that happens, ministry occurring every day. It's our opportunity right now to give our 10%, our tithes, back to the Lord. Because remember, your giving allows ministry to occur every day. There are three ways to give. We know there's a check. We know there's online in the QR code in the seat back in front of you. I encourage you to step out and give and be a part, an active part of ministry occurring every day. Let's pray. I always want to say thank you, Lord, for the privilege of a way to give back to you. For I'm honored that the one who is the maker of the universe has made a way for me to do that. And Lord, I pray you'd bless this giving today. Bless the gift and the giver in Jesus' name, so ministry can continue to go forth. Amen.
So, also, right now, for those joining us online, we're so thankful you are joining with us. We're so blessed to be able to gather here with you online at Journey Church. So welcome home. Welcome to Journey Church as we continue week two of The Lies We Believe with Pastor Vince Farrell. Money.
Well, I want to say good morning to those of you here in person and to those of you watching online. We are in part two of The Lies We Believe. Say it with me, the
lies.
Yeah, we all believe some lies. Now, as we talk about the subject this morning, let me just clarify that I believe it's one of the four elements that God the Father has given us to be a steward over, to be a manager over. Four elements I'm talking about is our time, our talent, our treasure, which deals with money, and then, of course, our testimony. Amen? Has God done something for you? Has God done something for you?
Yes.
Then let us be good stewards of that testimony and share it with people. Now, let's talk about money for a moment this morning, and I'm going to make you a promise. Are you ready? Three of you. Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to make you a promise this morning. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay, here's my promise. I am not going to ask you for money. Four of you. Okay, let's reverse that. Let's take up another offering. So let me give us this clear understanding that if you do what culture says when it comes to money, you will get culture-like results. Say that again. If you do what culture says when it comes to money, then you're going to get culture-like results. But the good news is, if you do Redeemer, if you do what the Redeemer says about money, then you will get redeemed results. I'm going to let that soak in just for a second. Because that is completely opposite of what you and I have been trained to do. John chapter 8, verse 12 says, again, Jesus spoke, saying to them, I am the light of the world. I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but have light of life. Now, I'll be honest with you, when it comes to the subject of money, many of us are walking in darkness. Maybe you're here this morning, maybe you're watching at home, that you'd be honest, you're in a dark season, that it seems that you're carrying with you some bondage. You feel bound because of the pressures of the bills. You feel guilty. You, looking back, there are some embarrassing decisions you made that you're paying for today. I want us to understand that this morning, you don't have to live in darkness. This morning, you can live in the light. You can live in the light of revelation of what Jesus says concerning our treasure. So I want to talk to us this morning a few lies that you and I have been fed, dangled in front of us, that maybe we've bit down hook, line, and sinker. Here's the first one that culture tells you. It says, you don't make enough money. Will you say that with me and let's make it personal? Say I. Say it like you meant it. I don't make
enough money.
All right, now some of us in here, we believe that. But I want you to understand something when it comes to biblical truths. And that's what I want to do. This isn't Vince Farrell saying these words. This is God's word speaking life-giving principles to darkness. The darkness is you've been fed a lie that if you could only make more money, then you can have what you want. If you, you know, work a few more hours, pick up a second or a third job. If you have more shifts and you make more money, then you'll be able to afford what you want, what you need, what you like. And the truth of the matter is that every single one of us in this place have been given exactly what God can trust you with. Now let that soak in just for a moment. Because God has given you the exact amount that He knows He can trust you with. And it begs the question, if I want more, why am I not getting more? Because you're not being faithful with what you already have been given. That hurts. Believe me, I hurt. That hurts me. And that's not, again, here's what Jesus said. He who is faithful with very little things is also faithful with much. And he who is dishonest with very, this word right here, and I'm using the Amplified Bible because it parallels faithful and dishonesty. And that's sobering to think that when I look at my paycheck, when I look at what I'm spending, when I look at the end of the month and I'm wanting and needing, the reality of it is I have been dishonest with what God has given me. I bought some things that maybe I shouldn't have bought to be able to afford the things that I should need to put priority on. He who is faithful with little. How much is your little? Some of us this morning, maybe your little is $200 a week. Maybe your little is $2,000 a week. I don't know what your little is, but whatever your little is, that's what God has looked at your track record to say, I can trust this person with this amount. Here's the second lie we've been fed. You'll be happy if you just have. What is it? Now, I asked us earlier, what is the one thing that really, if it was me, if I was sitting down with you and someone said, hey, what do you love to spend money on? Boy, that's going to be a tough, because I love to spend money on trips. The family, us going and taking trips together, because a good friend of mine told me things don't last very long, but memories last forever. I thought, ooh, that's a good word, Pastor Will. We were out working one day, and he said, and I was like, ooh, I just got a little conviction right there. And so looking for ways to make memories. So for me, I love spending money on trips and He-Man characters. But we're not going to talk about my sin. We're going to talk about your sin, okay? But we all have something that we love to, and what we've done is we've bought this idea. Man, if I could just have that, then this would make my life complete. This would make my life happy. Maybe if I had a newer car, a bigger house. Oh, Lord, if you bless me with a bigger house, I'll use it for your glory. I'll start a small group. 3 years later, you still ain't started a small group. Right. Amen or oh me, I'll take either one at this point, all right? If I could just have those golf clubs, if I could just have those season tickets, if I could just have that newest phone, if I could just have more guns, whatever it is, if I could just get that Wind Raider He-Man Classic Edition, my hobby would be complete. So we all fall victim to this lie, don't get me wrong, because we live in a culture that worships stuff. That's the basic bottom line. We live in a culture that worships stuff, and we believe the newer the stuff, the better our happiness. Now, understand that money, in case you didn't know, money is talked about more than any other subject in the New Testament. Jesus himself talked about money more than anything else. Here's what you might not know. That whenever money is talked about, there is always a lot of caution put around it. So let's just mentally parallel this. Money, caution. That whenever we think about money, let's just be cautious about it. Whenever we're about to swipe the card or pay the bill, let's just put some caution around it. Is this something that I need in my life? And if that answer is yes, then ask the question, why? Because what happens, and I don't know if you've heard this, I love this, it's fine to own stuff. Just don't let stuff own you. Now, we can all agree with that, and it sounds real good and catchy because we put certain words in order, and it sounds real catchy like a fortune cookie. But then we don't really pay attention to, well, how do we know if stuff owns us? I'm glad you asked. Let me give us three things to just be aware of, to have caution towards, to see if stuff owns us. Number one, two and three, did you go in debt for it? This is the biggest one. Did you go into debt? Did you spend money on it that now if you don't use it, it feels like a waste, and so you have to use it, therefore you're not plugged in church because the only free time you have to use it is on the weekends. Is your identity and contentment and your joy in it? In other words, are you always comparing yourself with others? Are you trying to keep up with the Joneses? Because there's no contentment. Does it take away from biblical priorities? And before I jump on the bandwagon to say, talk about tithing, because I think Miss Bobby did a magnificent job teaching us that. Amen? Amen? Let's even go beyond tithing to a Sunday morning. What about giving outside the church to help other organizations? Do you know that's a biblical standard? If you're here this morning, and please hear my heart, but if you're here this morning and you say, I can't afford to give 10% of my income to the church, then I promise you, you're not giving 10% of your income to savings for retirement, 10% of your income to outside the church to organizations that need help too. Whoa, I just did the math, Pastor Vince. You're saying 70% is what I should live on and the other 30% give to other areas? Yep. Biblically speaking. I forgot to tell us that you need to put on your steel-toed shoes this morning. So how do we break out of that then? Okay, Pastor Vince, I hear what you're saying. How do we, if we realize that money has us, that we're slave to these things, how do we break out of it? How do we make sure that our stuff doesn't own us? Number one, if you're taking notes, and I hope you will, because it's not up here, this is just freebie right here. You can write down on your smartphone. Number one, we overcome stuff getting our heart by practicing gratitude. Gratitude. Being thankful. I've never heard anyone pray, God, I thank you for everything I have in my life. I just want more. I love how Christine Kane says it. Gratitude is not just what he has given us, but what he has entrusted to us. Wow. What God has given you right now, is there gratitude for it? Is this understanding that God, you've given me this. You've given me this job, this ability to earn an income, this extra sitting job, this family. You've given me this. And so with this, my gratitude reflects not just that I'm happy that you've given it to me, but you've given it to me for a purpose. That's how we keep things from owning us. Second thing is humility. Say that with me, humility. I love how our very own Dr. Dale Yurton says it. Humility is not thinking of yourself less. It's thinking of yourself not at all. We are told constantly, watch out for number one. We can't do life always looking, what's in it for me? What do I get out of it? Well. We have to look at life by what we can give, what we can tribute. I love this virtue we have on our wall. It says, we are spiritual contributors, not spiritual consumers. That was written in love and compassion, because what I wanted to write is, we are spiritual givers, not spiritual leeches. Here's a third one, contentment. Contentment, now listen, contentment is not apathy. Contentment is not laziness. Contentment doesn't mean you don't have goals or work hard. No, we should be doing those things. Contentment is peace the Holy Spirit gives us, knowing what you're doing is for a reason. Contentment is peace that the Holy Spirit gives us, knowing what you have, what you've been given, and what you're doing with that is for purpose. 1 Timothy 6, chapter 6 through 8. Yet true godliness with contentment is itself great wealth. Some of us in this room, you may make a lot of money, but it is stressful to lay your head on the pillow. You lie awake, pondering, what if, how will I, can I, when will? And your soul is not at peace. Possibly. The great reasoning is you're not content. I love how this reads. After all, if we bought nothing, we brought nothing with us when we came into this world, and we can't take anything with us when we leave it. So, if we have enough food and clothing, let us be content. So let's just bring it back to the understanding. Money, caution. Caution. Here's the third one. The more you make, the more valuable you are. Did you know that money is the only scorecard we have in life that we can actually look to see how we're doing in? Finances are the only thing that there's a number next to it. And we can tell exactly how you're doing because there's a scorecard next to it. Money has a number. What you owe versus what you own. And culture has taught us that our net worth equals our self-worth. And I've got some great news for us this morning. Your self-worth is not your net worth. You are more than the money you make. You are more than the past mistakes you've made. You are more than what you bring home. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Now, you are not your mistakes. Some of us in this room, we're paying for our mistakes. It's carried over from season to season. A bad financial decision in your 20s, and you're still living with that held over your head in your 30s. But listen, Christ has given us new life, which means when we surrender to Him and we lay it down at His feet, He doesn't see the mistakes. He sees a person who's been forgiven and now has the grace to pick up and move in the right direction. Do you understand that? Which means, don't put a period at that sentence. Let's put a comma and keep going. Which means your spending should look different now that you're a believer. Asking Jesus to forgive you does not negate the responsibility we have to live as believers. Don't allow the condemnation to dictate how you live today. You are not your mistake. Amen. We are new creatures in Christ. Amen. But we also have a responsibility to spend our finances differently than non-believers. Amen. Number four. The fourth lie that you and I are told, at least I was told this in school, you'll figure it out. Figure it out as you go. I mean, I don't know what they're doing in today's school classroom. We had home ec. Anyone else had home ec? Did anyone else have those three months of how to do a bank account, a checkbook? Look at, hold them up high. I want to see this. Okay. A third of the room here. Two-thirds of us probably weren't given any type of teaching when it came to money. And so we've been left to kind of figure this thing out as we go. So what I want to do is I want to give you five biblical truths to combat this, figure it out as you go. Because some of us, let's just be honest, we haven't figured it out too well. Right? So here it is. Let me give you the first thing to do. Number one, live on a written budget. I'm going to give you time to write that down or take a photo of that because we need that. The Bible says, Jesus said, I'm going to blame Jesus for this one. Jesus said, suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Won't you first sit down, calculate and estimate what it's going to cost, do the research and figure it out, then to see if you have enough money to complete it? It goes on to say, because if you don't and you fall short, people are going to say you're a fool. What a foolish person. Let's be honest. How many times do we sit down at the table, either by ourselves or with our family, and say, okay, here is where we're at. On your phone, on your notepad, on a piece of paper, from today throughout the rest of the week till Sunday, from now until next Sunday, write down everything you spend money on. After church today, you're going to go to a restaurant and you're going to spend $30. Write it down. Tonight, before you come to men's fellowship, you're going to stop by and pick up a bag of chips. Please don't do that. We have plenty from last month. But you're going to pick up something. Write it down. Tomorrow morning, you wake up, go to Starbucks. Write it down. You remember you got Netflix. Write it down. And for 1 week, look at what you're spending your money on. That will help you get to a budget. Because here's the problem. You and I say this. We get to the end of our month and we're like, man, why am I only got $15 left in my account? Because you didn't make a budget. John Maxwell says it best. A budget is people telling their money what to do instead of wondering where it went. That is so good. Get that tattooed on your heart right there. I mean, I've been in the same boat. The end of the month, I'm like, where did all my money go? Y'all have those moments? Where did my money go? You didn't budget. That's why you're wondering. Because I ain't gonna let money own me. Which is number two. Here's the second biblical principle. Number one, formulate a written budget. Not an estimated budget, a written budget is what we're going to tell our money what to do each month. And if it turns out we're telling our money to go do things too much, we're going to have to start raking it in. And we're going to start telling ourselves, sell that. And we'll start telling ourselves, discontinue that monthly subscription. And we'll start telling ourselves, lay off on the coffee. We're going to start telling ourselves, no more frivolous spending. That's what we got to tell ourselves. Because if we don't, our money tells us what to do. We're not going to do that. That's not biblical. We tell our money what to do. My money works for me, sucker. Okay, number two. Avoid debt. That seems to be a no-brainer. But the rich rules over the poor. The rich rules. There's no promises of God in the Bible. Well done, poor servant. Because you had to borrow money to pay for things? Ugh, there's none of that. Again, there's tons of caution. Caution before you take out that loan. Hey, caution, because when you take that money loan, they now lord over you. Here's a good one. I love to quote this one. This is what my pastor taught me. If your output is more than your income, then your upkeep becomes your downfall. I just saved you $500 on Dave Ramsey material right there. He spends 10 weeks teaching you that. There it is, freebie, right there. If you're spending more than you make, then what you surround yourself to live comfortably in life will be your downfall. Maybe not economically, maybe, but definitely spiritually. Your soul will be so unrest and uneasy. Mentally, you'll be hypoventilating. How are we going to do this? Looking for creative ways to pay the bills. It will be your downfall. Number three, foster high quality relationships. What? Yeah, biblically. Bad company corrupts good character. Who you surround yourself with, listen, if you surround yourself with people that cuss like a sailor, it will become part of your verbiage. That's just part of it. If you surround yourself with people who spend more than they make, who don't make good financial decisions, you will think that's the norm and you'll do the same. It's just how it is. So become the fifth person in the club of four millionaires. Hang around people that make wise financial decisions. Hang around people that put a budget together. It doesn't mean you shun people. It doesn't mean you're not friendly to people. It simply means in your close-knit circle, we want good counsel when it comes to finances. Number four, save and invest. The wise man, opposite of foolish, the wise man saves for the future, but the foolish man spends whatever he gets. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, I am not an expert in this field. There are some people in our community that you can set up appointments and say, hey, I need to invest in the future. What do I do? That's what a wise person does. I want to be wise and not foolish. How about you? Amen? All right, let me back up because I've been quoting several different people. Christine Kane, Dale Yerton, John Maxwell. But man, listen, the Bible tells us over and over and over again, when we don't do these things, we're acting like a fool. We're being foolish. And it was the great theologian, Mr. T, who said, I pity the fool. So don't do that. Number five. Here we go. Number five, you're writing it down. Be radically generous. Radically. I put that word radically generous. Listen to what Jesus said, Matthew 6:21. For where your treasure is, money, there your heart will be also. Your heart follows the money. Did you catch that? See, we think it's the other way. We think it's we tell our money to follow what we love. But it's not. Our heart follows the treasure. Where we put money. We've trained our heart what to value. Dave Ramsey gives this wonderful story. He says, when you start doing these things, you're going to start having more income. So here's what you need to do. And I love this story. I think we should try it, to be honest with you. He goes, on Thanksgiving Day, you're sitting with your family. You're having a great feast. You're enjoying your time. Sometime throughout the day, go to your local 24-hour place. Now, for us here in Hopkinsville, I mean, I think of places like Waffle House. It'd be a good one. So go to Waffle House and take your kids because we're building a legacy. And go into Waffle House because those ladies, those men, they're working on Thanksgiving. And go and just get you a cup of coffee. You don't have to be a big meal. You've already eaten a meal. Get you a cup of coffee and as you talk and say Happy Thanksgiving, take one of those $100 bills out of your wallet. Oh, I can't do that, Pastor Vince. I can't do $100. No. You will if you'll do these things. Take one of those $100 bills from your wallet, put it underneath the coffee, cup, pay your bill, thank them, and then get in your car and watch. Watch as she goes to clean up and she sees that $100 bill. That's a real $100 bill, not some Jesus track. I'm telling you, I better not hear of any of you doing that. I will lay hands on you repeatedly and with force. Y'all know I used to be a wait server. Don't do that, amen? I'm looking at you online. Don't you be doing that. It's a terrible testimony. But a real $100 bill. And then watch, and then show your kids. Hey, watch. Let's watch what happens. And watch her face light up. Watch her break down crying because someone gave a radical blessing. You don't walk back in and say, it was me. I go to Journey Church. No. Hello? No, you just sit and watch. Radical generosity. That we be people who, yeah, we tithe because we're managers of our finances. But beyond the tithe, we look for ways that we can bless others and give him the credit. Your heart follows your money. When you live with this type of understanding that everything we have, God's given us, then it releases you from financial burden. Because, church, it's hard to be generous when you got to spend every dollar paying for everything you have. The reason why Jesus spoke so much about money is because he wants your heart. Your heart follows the money. So he intercepts the money issue and says, listen, I want your heart. If I can have your heart, then man, you can be a blessing to people around you. If I have your heart, you can further the purpose of why I'm here. If I have your heart, then when your heart breaks, I can mend it and heal it. When it's hurting, I can hold it. Because you trust me with it. If I have your heart, I have you. And that's what I want. But unfortunately, to get to you, I've got to cut through a lot of lies that you've believed about money. Amen? Amen. Let's pray.
Welcome to Journey Church. Our church exists to help people find God, experience freedom, discover their purpose, and make a difference. If you have any questions about Journey Church, please visit us at ourjourney.tv.
Now, let's go this week and be the church in our community as we focus on loving God and loving others. See you next week.